JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for March the 19th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the main topics for today are the US dollar rally, the resumption in the slide of equities, new stimulus actions by the ECB, the Fed and the RBA, the coronavirus, and the cable slide in territories last seen in 1985. Now, as for today, we have two central banks on the calendar, the Norges Bank and the SNB. And with regards to the indicators, the only ones worth mentioning are the US initial jobless claims and the US Philly Fed manufacturing index. As always, let's start with the performance in the currency world. The dollar continued rallying against all the other G10 currencies on Wednesday and during the Asian morning Thursday. It gained the most versus NOK, Aussie, Kiwi, and the pound in that order, while it eked out the least gains versus the Swiss franc, the euro, and the yen. The relative strength of the yen and the franc, combined with the weakening of the risk-linked Aussie and Kiwi, suggests that the financial world has turned back to risk-off trading. That said, the fact that the dollar outperformed even the traditional safe havens, the yen and the franc, as well as the further tumble in gold, point to what we have said yesterday. Namely, investors appear to be liquidating positions everywhere in favor of holding cash, and especially dollars, the world's reserve currency. Even bond yields were up as investors ran out of bonds as well. In a leveraged world, this may have been happening in order to cover losses and margin calls in risk assets like equities. Shifting our attention to the equity world, we see a sea of red. Major EU and US indices turned down again, closing well in the red, with the negative investor morale rolling into the Asian trading today. Both Japan's Nikkei and China's Shanghai composite slid 1.04% and 0.98% respectively. Yesterday morning, we noted that we don't expect Tuesday's bounce to continue, adding that since February 20th, we rarely saw two consecutive days of gains in the equity markets. All this comes to confirm that observation. Overnight, major central banks proceeded with more stimulus measures, but apparently the efforts were once again unsuccessful in calming panicked investors. In out-of-scheduled meetings, the ECB pledged to buy 750 billion euros in bonds throughout the whole year, while the Fed promised to make loans to banks that offer asset purchased from money market mutual funds as collateral. What's more, the RBA cut interest rates to a new all-time low of 0.25% and announced that it will start QE purchases for the first time in its history. The market reaction to the extra stimulus efforts enhances our long-standing view that that the worst is not behind us yet. We repeat that with monetary and fiscal easing, consumers have to get out of their homes and start spending for the edges of the global economy to restart. With the daily infected cases and deaths hitting new records day by day, we see that as a very hard task. Just for the record, only yesterday we had 20,584 new infections and 973 new deaths. Now, as for the economic outlook, remember that when everyone was pointing to a temporary impact only in the first quarter, our call was that the economic wounds could well drag into the second quarter. It appears that this will be the case, and if any vaccine does not start being distributed to the world soon, the globe could suffer well beyond the first half of the year. Now back to the currencies, the pound was among the main losers, with cable tumbling well below its 2019 low of 1.1958, and is now testing territories last seen in 1985. Apart from the broader dollar strength, investors and traders may have been abandoning the pound, as the last thing they would like to do at the moment is holding assets with extra risk. And the extra risk related to the pound is Brexit and the transition period negotiations. It seems that pound traders were quick to erase from their memory the 50 basis points cut by the Bank of England and the large fiscal stimulus package announced by Chancellor Rishi Sunak. Now, overall, we maintain the view that equities have not hit the bottom yet, and that risk-linked currencies will continue tumbling. Given the aforementioned argument, the pound may also be poised for further declines. The safe havens, yen, franc and the euro may continue standing tall, but we would avoid exploiting gains in these currencies against the dollar. Dollar is the king nowadays. Thus, with all that in mind, currency pairs that may be poised to continue sliding at a decent pace are the Aussie dollar, Kiwi dollar and cable, followed by Aussie yen, Kiwi yen, pound yen, Aussie franc, Kiwi franc and pound franc. On the other hand, Euro Aussie and Euro Kiwi may keep trending north. Now, as for the rest of today's events, during the European session, the central bank torch will be passed to the Norges Bank and the SNB. When they last met, Norwegian policymakers kept interest rates untouched at 1.5% and noted that the policy rate will remain at the present level in the coming period. However, last week, inflation data disappointed largely, with the headline rate tumbling to 0.9% year over year from 1.8% and the core one sliding to 2.1% year over year from 2.9%. Now, with central banks worldwide easing their respective policies in order to prevent a global recession due to the effects of the coronavirus, a slump in Norwegian inflation may come as an extra reason for policymakers to follow through, especially after the sharp tumble in oil prices. Passing the ball to the SNB, this may be the only central bank which is unlikely to ease this week. Having the lowest interest rate globally at minus 0.75%, the bank may prefer to fight the virus crisis by intervening in the FX market in order to prevent the franc from keep strengthening, especially with the currency attracting heaven flows recently. Another reason we don't expect the SNB to touch interest rates is because the ECB refrained from doing so. The bank may just adopt a more dovish language and strengthen its intervention signals. Now, as for the rest of the day, the only releases worth to mention are the initial jobless claims for last week, which are expected to have risen to 220,000 from 211,000, and the US Philly Fed Manufacturing Index, which is forecast to have declined to 10 from 36.7. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 8 o'clock AM GMT time. You can find the link in the description below. So, goodbye, have a great day, and I hope I see you again tomorrow.
JFT. Just fair and direct.